just something about that name.
Hello. Thank you for allowing us to spend this time together. I travel around the country quite a bit, and I like to ask people this question. If the Lord were to come right now, do you know for sure, nothing doubting, that you'd go home to be with Him, to live forever? That's the question I'd like to ask you today. If the Lord were to come right now, do you know for sure, nothing doubting, that you would go home to be with Him, to live forever?
You're saying, yes, Lee, I know I'd go to heaven. I'd like to ask you, how do you know? What makes you so sure? Maybe you're saying, well, I'm a Christian. Well, then apparently you know the Bible when Jesus said, no man cometh to the Father but by me. But maybe you're saying, well, I'm not a Christian, but I know I'm going to heaven because I'm just a good moral person. I'm a good father or a good mother. I've never killed anybody. I've never kidnapped a single person in all my life. Maybe your answer is like the answer a man told me in Tennessee when he said, Larry, I wouldn't mind if you would open up the book of my life and read it cover to cover. I've been that good of a moral person. He said, oh, I've done a few things that I'm not necessarily proud of, but I'd like to show you that I'm just a good moral, law-abiding citizen. Or maybe like a man in Florida who told me, well, he said, Larry, I've never done anything enough that would jeopardize my relationship with the Lord. I know that if He were to come right now, I'd just simply go home to be with Him to live forever. Well, actually, I think a lot of times, don't we? We have an idea that the Lord has a gigantic scales up there in the sky, and He's put our good deeds on one side and our bad deeds on the other side. And if our good deeds outweigh the bad, then we're going to be able to make it to heaven. But if our bad deeds outweigh the good, then we are in trouble. Well, the question is, what does God say about that matter? I mean, can good people depend upon their own goodness to get them to heaven? Does God say something about our goodness, His power to save us? Well, there's something about God now that we have to understand, really, for us to be able to answer the question. We have to understand God's nature so that we can really understand the fact that we are, as people, in a predicament. First of all, there's something, as I said, we have to understand about God Himself. It's amazing, in the Bible, Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 22, Jesus now committed no sin. No guile was found in His mouth. Now, when I say Jesus, please understand I'm referring to God. For in John chapter 8 and verse 24, Jesus claims to be God. In fact, in John chapter 8 and verse 58, Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. So, when we refer to Jesus, please understand we are referring to God. Right here in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 22, the Bible says that Jesus did no sin, no guile was found in His mouth. Over here in Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, the Bible says that Jesus was tempted in all points as we are tempted, and yet He was without sin. Now, is it that God can sin, but He just simply chooses not to, just chooses that there be no sin found in His life, no guile found in His mouth? But that He can sin, He just simply chooses not to? Is that the case? Absolutely not. For you see, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 18 that it is in fact impossible for God to sin. Right here in this particular case, it says it's impossible for God to lie. And that's dealing with a moral matter. It's impossible for God to sin. He can't do it. It's not that He chooses not to. God can't do it. The Bible says in Psalm 92 and verse 15, the Lord is upright. There is no unrighteousness in Him. Absolutely none. Not even one smidgen, could I say? I mean, there is no unrighteousness in the Lord. Not even a little bit. Now, you see, there's a problem. For the Bible also says in Romans chapter 3 and verse 10 concerning us people, there is none righteous. About us, no, not one. Now, with the Lord, there is no unrighteousness in Him. But with us, there is none of us who are righteous. Now, God is so holy and so righteous and so just, He can't tolerate sin in His holy presence. It's not that He chooses not to. It's that He can't.
And the problem is, we are the contamination. There is no righteousness in us. Now, we know what contamination is, don't we? We know what something being contaminated really involves. Let's say, for example, that we're at a family reunion, all right, and it's breakfast time. And, there are a lot of people there. And the cooks have decided to cook up some bacon and eggs. And so a couple of the cooks are frying up 100 eggs. Now, that's a lot of eggs, right? But all of a sudden, one of the cooks comes across an egg that's obviously a bad egg. And she looks over there and she sees a great big old pan full of eggs, and they're putting it over in a gigantic plate over here, you know, where there's just a great big stack of eggs, and it's all being mixed up, and she decides, well, no one's going to know this, are they? So she just goes ahead and breaks that egg and throws it into the frying pan as well. Now, would you like to eat some of those eggs? We know what contamination is, even in the midst of a lot of eggs, right? Now, God is a big God. A huge God. In fact, the Bible says He fills heaven and earth. Would it be all right to believe that there is a little contamination in God? According to the Bible, there is no contamination. There is no unrighteousness in God. God is so holy, so righteous, so just, He cannot tolerate sin in His holy presence. Now, we want to go be with God, don't we? Yet we are sinful. We are unrighteous. We are unholy. How can God work that out? Can we depend upon our goodness, our righteousness to get us to heaven? Has God given us a gigantic scales up there in heaven and He's put our good deeds on one side and our bad deeds on the other? Is that the way He's able to work it out? Well, let me ask you, how many times do you suppose the average person sins during the day? Have you ever put a pencil to that one? Now, you know, there are all kinds of ways that a person can sin. He can sin by the things that he does. He can sin by the things he doesn't do, you know, things he should have done. 1,000 times a day, 500 times a day, 250, 100, 50. You know, we're getting more and more moral all the time, aren't we? How about 3 times a day? Now, you know, a person can even sin in his mind. I would say that if a person sinned no more than 3 times a day, he would be some kind of a super moral person, wouldn't you? Well, let's do some calculating. 3 times a day times how many days in the year? 365. Now, that's about 1,000 times a year, isn't it? Well, let's say that a person is responsible to God for 65 years of his life. But 65 times 1,000 is 65,000 violations on his record against God's will. 65,000, and we called him a super moral person? Let's divide that in half, all right? 30,000. How about 15,000? 7,500? We're getting more and more moral all the time, right? Well, how many times does it take for a person to find himself in trouble with God? Well, it's amazing that the Bible says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, the wages of sin. Just one. Sin. Sin is sin. All it takes is one. For the wages of sin is death. God is so holy, so righteous, so just, He cannot tolerate even one sin in His presence. And that's why the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, that you and I, who are people, have been separated from God because of sin in our lives. It is as though God has, well, that He's drawn a great big circle, and He says, now this is where I am. I am perfectly moral. There is no unrighteousness in me. And He says, if we understand the first 2 chapters of Genesis correctly, He says, I want you with me. Man, you were made to glorify and honor me. Now, as long as man has never violated God's moral law, now that's where God lives. There is no unrighteousness in him. Anytime man lives perfectly along with God's moral law, he deserves to be with God because that's where God lives. But anytime we human beings violate God's moral code, moral law of ethics, then, according to Isaiah 59, verses 1 and 2, we have been separated from God because of that. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4 that sin is a transgression of God's law. Now, what does transgression mean? Well, when you transport something, what do you do with it? Well, you take it from one place to another, right? Well, when you transgress God's law, what you're doing is you're stepping away from it and you are breaking His law. And God is saying, anytime you break my moral code, you step away from me. Now, how many times do we have to sin in order for us to find ourselves in trouble by stepping away from God? Romans 6, verse 23, for the wages of just one, sin, is death. Death. In the context of Romans chapter 6, you find that he is speaking of hell, eternal torment in a living hell. We have a legal problem in God's judicial system, don't we? For the Bible says, Romans 3, verse 10, remember? And Romans 3, verse 23, there is none righteous, not a one. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the problem with it is that the wages of it is that we be eternally separated from God in a living hell. That's death. That's death. Eternal death. You know, I have talked to a lot of people who have insisted that, well, now, Larry, you know, I know that I must be all right with God because look how He has blessed me. I mean, I have good children, I pay my debts, and I'm really well blessed as far as paying my debts are concerned. I'm an honest citizen, and so I live a good moral life, and I am blessed as a result of it. So I therefore must be all right with the Lord because, well, I'm just always blessed. I know that one person told me that. She said, Larry, I'm all right with God because he hasn't cursed me. He's given me good children, good grandchildren, a great income. I live in a free country. I just have all of these blessings. So I know, you know, that the Lord is going to save me. I'm all right in my relationship with Him. She wasn't a Christian, but she believed she, in her relationship with the Lord, was all right. Once upon a time, several years ago, it wasn't in America, it was in another country. There was a young man who was arrested for murder. He was tried and convicted in this particular country. Well, he ended up on death row. One day, a medical doctor was visiting death row, the prisoners there, and of course, this prisoner welcomed him into his cell, and the doctor asked him, son, is there anything I can do for you? And the boy said, yes, sir. He said, before I am taken out and executed, I haven't made out my will. I would like for you to get me a pencil and some paper that I may make out my will. Well, the medical doctor looked at him with a question on his face, and he said, son, apparently you don't understand. In this country, when the judge pronounces the death sentence on a man, legally speaking, he's dead. He said, there's not a court in this land who would respect your will, now dated. Once a man has been given the death sentence, legally speaking, he said, he's dead. You know, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust. God gives blessings to everyone. But legally speaking, they're dead in their sin. I like Andy Griffith. I suppose the Andy Griffith Show is my most favorite show on television. And you know maybe some of the characters in Andy Griffith. There's Aunt Bee, and of course there's Opie and Gomer Pyle and Barney and the rest of them. Well, you remember on the Andy Griffith Show what the cell looks like down there at the jailhouse. I mean, Aunt Bee, you know, has really fixed up the place. She's put wallpaper on the walls and pictures on the walls and, you know, a tablecloth on the table and a fancy chair in there. It's a real comfortable place. And she brings in, you know, chicken and dumplings and all kinds of good things to eat. Prisoners fight, you know, to get into Andy Taylor's cell just to get a taste of Aunt Bee's cooking. Well, there are the blessings. Problem is, when the prisoner is in that cell, he's still in the cell. Legally speaking, he's a prisoner. So it is in our lives. We may be living in a beautiful cell block, you know, with wallpaper and with it raining and the green grass and the rainbows and the flowers. But legally speaking, as far as God's judicial system is concerned, we're dead. We're dead in sin.
And the Bible says, no, we cannot depend upon our goodness to get us to heaven. Legally speaking, we're dead. We're not good enough. Jesus said, except a man cometh through him, no man can make it to the Father. I am so glad that the judge, I'm speaking of God, that judge has also made it possible for us to have a way back. God, the judge, has given us a way back. While Romans 6, verse 23 says, the wages of sin is death, there is a second part to that verse. It says, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. You see, there's a difference between a wage and a gift. The wage is we've earned eternal separation. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our precious Lord. Some years ago, a young lady in the state of California broke a rather severe traffic law. The officer brought her in to the judge, and the judge read the accusation against her. And he looked up at the young lady and said, young lady, do you plead guilty or not guilty? And she said, well, I'm guilty, Your Honor. He said, well, the penalty for this law broken is either 10 days in jail or a $100 fine. He stood up, stepped down around the judge's bench, took out his billfold, and laid $100 on the bench, paying her fine. Now, I have a couple of questions here. To be an honorable judge, did he have to administer justice? Absolutely. He had no choice in that matter. You see, God is just. He's righteous. He's holy. But let me ask you, did this judge in California have to pay her fine? He chose to do that. It cost him. Paying the penalty for legal problems broken always costs. It cost him. But he didn't have to do it. He chose to do it. You see, at one point he was her judge. At the next point, he, as her father, paid her penalty for her. He didn't have to do it. He chose to do it. The wages of sin must be paid. It's death. But God chooses to give us the free gift of His own Son that we might have eternal life. You see, here's the problem that you and I are in. According to the Bible, in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1 and following, the Bible says, behold, the Lord's hand is not short that He cannot save, nor His ear heavy that it cannot hear. But your iniquities, He says, have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden His face from you, so that He will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies. Your tongue has muttered perversity. Lord, we ask, how can you get me out of these crimes? How can you get me away from this guilt? How can you once again draw me into yourself? Is there anyone who can pay the penalty of this law I have broken? He says, yes, there is. For you see, in Isaiah chapter 53, speaking of the coming Christ and what God then did to Jesus for us, verses 4, 5, and 6, God says concerning Jesus, He has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed Him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon Him. And by His stripes, we are healed. The problem is, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on Him, on Jesus, the iniquity of us all. Jesus is our substitute. Jesus paid our penalty. Jesus is our atonement. He is the one who takes care of our legal problem with God. How do we get in on what Jesus came to pay for to get us out of our trouble? I'm saving that until next time. The point of today's discussion is, though, we cannot depend upon our own goodness to get us to heaven. We're not good enough. We're not righteous enough to get ourselves into heaven. We need Jesus. He, and only He, is our penalty payment. See you next time. There's just
something about that name.
Thank you for giving me this time with you. It means a lot to me. It is a most interesting and perceptive question. What if the Lord were to come right now? Can you say for sure, nothing doubting, that you would go home to be with Him, to live forever? What is your answer to that question? If the Lord were to come right now, can you say for sure, nothing doubting, that you would go home to be with Him, to live forever? Maybe you're sitting there saying, yes, Larry, there's not a doubt in my mind. I know for sure if the Lord were to come right now, I would go home to be with Him to live forever. I'd like to ask you, if that is your answer, how do you know? Upon what do you base your belief, your assurance that you would go home to be with Him to live forever? Well, maybe you're sitting there saying, well, Larry, I'm a Christian. A Christian. If you're saying you're a Christian, then obviously, you are appealing to Christ, and you recognize that we as human beings have a legal problem in God's judicial system. For the Bible says we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The Bible says the wages of that sin is death. But praise God, the Bible also says that God so loved this world, He gave His only begotten Son, as the Bible says, the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. In other words, Jesus is our penalty payment. And if you're saying you're a Christian, then you recognize that it's only Jesus who can pay that penalty for us. If you're saying you're a Christian, I would like to ask you, how do you believe you became a Christian? Was it at a particular time in your life? Where can you pinpoint the time that you believe you actually became a Christian? Well, maybe you're saying, well, Larry, I attended a revival service one night in my church on a Tuesday night, and I was so greatly moved by the preacher's sermon that, I just responded to the invitation. And I went down to that front pew, and the preacher met me there, and he asked me what I wanted, and I told him that I wanted to become a Christian. And it was in prayer that he led the entire congregation, and he prayed something like, Lord, this person wants to become a Christian. He's claiming you as his personal Savior. He's calling upon your name to save him. Make him a Christian right here and now. Forgive him of his sins. Wash his sins away in the blood of Jesus. Make him a Christian right here and now. In Jesus' name, amen. And as you looked around the congregation there, you saw smiles on everyone's faces because you believed with all of your heart it was right then and there that you became a Christian. Maybe you're saying, no, Larry, that's not how it happened in my life. Maybe you're saying it happened when I was younger in the privacy of my own bedroom. I was reading the Bible one night and I was all by myself. I had been praying a while and I just felt the presence of the Lord. And it was in the privacy of my bedroom that I claimed Jesus as my Savior. And I know He forgave me of all my sins and I became a Christian right there. Maybe you're saying, well, Larry, really, with me, I've just always been a Christian. I was sprinkled as a baby, and I've just been a Christian all of my conscious life. And when I was 13, I went to a class, and I went through a confirmation to confirm my faith in Jesus. But as far as being a Christian is concerned, I've always been a Christian.
You know, I love to talk to people, and I suppose there are as many beautiful stories as there are beautiful people. We like to tell about Jesus Christ, don't we, and how we believe that he came into our lives. I love to talk to people. I love to hear their stories. Actually, now, you know, I didn't become a Christian that way, and I would like, if you don't mind, to be able to tell you my story. I hope you have your Bible, because, you see, my story relates to some things that are discussed right there in the Bible. May I tell you my story in regard to how I became a Christian? Do you have your Bible? If you will, please look at John chapter 8 and verse 24. I just happen to have my Bible opened already to this particular passage. And before we get into this passage, though, may I tell you how I, in my own experience, tried to approach the will of God that I might know how to become a Christian. You know, in life, there are some statements that we people make and we people hear that are statements that are extremely clear. In fact, they had to do with life and death matters, and they are so precisely clear in regard to those matters that we'd have to have help to misunderstand them. For example, what if you were to tell me, Larry, if you were to jump out of an airplane at 30,000 feet and you didn't have a parachute on, you shall surely die. Now, that's a life and death statement, isn't it? And I have no trouble understanding that. In fact, I would have to have help to misunderstand it. Well, I, speaking personally, have tried to go to God. And I've tried to ask Him, Lord, in particular with life and death, you know, heaven and hell, being saved or being lost, do you have any statements that are so precisely clear that I would have to have help to misunderstand them? In John chapter 8, if you'll run your eyes on down to verse 24, and if you have the red letter edition of the Bible, you can see that it's Jesus who is speaking right here. Look at the last part of verse 24. Jesus says, if you do not believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. Now, there is a life and death statement, isn't it? If you do not believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. Jesus is saying here that there is something that we have to believe. Now, what do we have to believe? Well, speaking personally, that's something that I wanted to know. Lord, what is it that I have to believe? That He is who He says He is. If I don't believe that He is who He says He is, what's going to happen to me? Well, He says right here, I'm going to die in my sins. Now, that's a life and death statement, isn't it? You know, I've talked to a lot of people, and they say, well, now, Larry, it doesn't really matter what you believe. Just, you know, as long as you're honest and sincere about it. Well, now, you know, we have to be honest and sincere about what we believe, no doubt about that. But, you know, in other areas of our lives, we don't believe that. Oh, here just not too long ago, we had a real problem in the northern part of the United States with someone going into various grocery stores and drug stores, and they were taking some Tylenol and putting some cyanide pills in them, remember? And then they would go back and put those little bottles on the shelves. Honest people, sincere people, would come in and buy those Tylenol bottles, go home, and believing that they would take care of their minor aches and pains, they took those pills, and now they're dead. They were honest and sincere, but you see, now they're honestly and sincerely dead, aren't they? Oh, listen, it does matter what we believe. We've got to be honest and sincere about what we believe, but it does matter what we are honestly and sincerely believing. Right here in John chapter 8, in verse 24, Jesus said, for if you do not believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. It is a life and death statement. So here, you know, I am as a human being, I want to be saved. And so I went to the Lord and I said, well, now, who are you? Well, you know, it's amazing. Right here in the Bible, we find the answers if we'll just keep studying. In Matthew chapter 16, starting with verse 13, the Bible says that Jesus was on the coast of Caesarea Philippi, and He was discussing this very thing with His disciples. He said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they gave Him various answers. They said, well, Jesus, some say you're John the Baptizer. Others say you're Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. Then Jesus asks them, "Who do you say that I am?" And it was here that Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, what was Jesus' answer to Peter when he had told him that? Did Jesus back up and say, "Oh, well, now, wait a minute, you know, I'm a good moral man, all right. I can tell you how to live a successful life, but to say I'm the Son of God, no, Peter, you're stretching it there." No, because if you'll read on, you'll find that Jesus said, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah," which means Simon, the son of a man named Jonah, in contrast to who Jesus is going to say he is the son of. He said, "For flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto thee, but my Father, which art in heaven." He is saying, "Peter, you're right. I am the son of the one who dwells in the heavenlies. I am the Son of God." Now, what does it mean to believe that Jesus is the Son of God? It means to believe that Jesus is God. Maybe you're sitting there saying, "Well, now, wait a minute. How can someone be the son of something and be that something at the same time?" Well, you see, we're talking about an identity. What if I were to tell you that both of my parents were fine Kentucky-bred, thoroughbred racehorses? What would that make me? Well, a horse of some kind, right? I hope a good one. But when I tell you, though, that both of my parents are humans, what does that make me? Human. Well, here comes a human, a man, and he refers to himself on several occasions, in fact, right there in Matthew 16, as being the Son of Man. Jesus says he is the Son of Man, the son of a human. His mother is human. But you see, Jesus is also the Son of God. What does that make him? It makes him God. Now, there are several verses in the Bible that demand that we understand that. For example, in John chapter 1, verse 1, the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. If you run your eyes on down to verse 14, the Bible says, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Who is that? Jesus. Therefore, Jesus, in verse 1, was in the beginning as the Word with God and was God. He simply, in verse 14, put on flesh and dwelt among us. In Colossians chapter 2 and verse 9, the Bible says that in Jesus dwelleth the fullness of the Godhead in bodily form. In other words, Jesus is 100% God. In Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 8, which is a quote from Psalm 45 and verse 6, God the Father, speaking to His Son, calls Him God. The quote is this, "But to the Son, God the Father says, Your throne, O God, lasts forever and ever." God the Father calls His own Son God. Jesus is 100% God. Now, we have to believe that. In fact, right there in John chapter 8 and verse 24, that's what Jesus is demanding. That's the very first verse that I, you know, gave to you today. In John chapter 8 and verse 24, what Jesus is saying is, if you do not believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. If you look at verse 24, you'll see that the pronoun He is in italics. And the reason it's in italics is because in the original language, the Greek language in which the Bible was written, the New Testament was written, it's not there. The King James translators just simply fill it in. Here is really what Jesus said. If you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins. I am. That's the expression Jesus used. Where did He get that expression? Well, back over here in Exodus chapter 3, you remember that Moses one day was standing before a burning bush, and a voice comes out of the burning bush commanding Moses to go back into the land of Egypt and free God's children of Israel. And Moses asks this voice, "Well, who are you? Who shall I say it is that sends me?" And what does the voice say? "I am who I am. Jehovah. I am is Jehovah." And that's the expression that Jesus uses in John chapter 8. He says, if you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins. In John chapter 8 and verse 58, if you'll run your eyes on down there, you'll notice that Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. Now, Jesus is God. If we don't believe it, there's that life and death statement. We're going to die in our sins. Now, here I am a human being, and I have to believe that Jesus is who He says He is. If I don't, I'm going to die in my sins. Now, please don't misunderstand. Jesus is one of the three persons in the Godhead. In Matthew chapter 3, Jesus is baptized by John. The Bible says that after that happens, all of a sudden, the Spirit of God descends in the form of a dove. All right, there are two persons. And then while there is the Word incarnate, Jesus, standing in the water, and then while the Bible says that there is the Spirit having descended in the form of a dove, all of a sudden, there is a voice that begins to speak out of the heavenlies that says, "This is my beloved Son." On the same scene, there are all three, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. In Matthew 28, Jesus names them as being the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. But my point is, Jesus, as being one of them, is 100% God. And if we don't believe it, we're going to die in our sins. Now, have you ever wondered why Jesus had to be both God and man? Have you ever asked the question, God, why can't you just save us people from up there in heaven? Why can't you just zap us with salvation? Have you ever asked why Jesus had to be both God and man? Well, the Bible has an answer. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says there is one God. Obviously, there is one God. And one mediator between God and man, himself man, Christ Jesus. Now, what's a mediator? A middleman. Isn't that what a mediator is? A go-between. A bridge. Now, a bridge is worthless, isn't it, unless it touches both shores. In Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, the Bible says that you and I as human beings have been separated from God because of sin. There's a gap now between you and God, between me and God, between us and God. We've been separated from God because of sin in our lives. If we're ever now going to be reunited with God, that gap has to be bridged. Between Monroe, Louisiana and West Monroe, Louisiana, where I live, there is the Ouachita River. There are five or six bridges that span that river. A few years ago, a barge came down the river and hit one of the pylons of one of the bridges and knocked half of the bridge into the water. You know what the highway department did to the good side? They blocked it off. Now, why would they do that? A bridge is worthless, obviously, unless it touches both shores, right? Now, why wasn't it good enough to believe that Jesus is John or Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the prophets? Men that are good men, God-fearing men, God-obeying men. That's what John was, Elijah, Jeremiah. They were all God-fearing, God-obeying men. Why wasn't it good enough to believe that Jesus was one of these? Jesus said, "Except you believe that I am He, you'll die in your sins." We've got to believe that Jesus is exactly who He says He is, or we're going to die in our sins. The problem was these good men the apostles named were wrong in their identity. All they were men. And because all they were humans, they touched only our shore. But because Jesus is both God and man, He touches both shores. He is human, He touches our shore. He is God. He touches God's shore. He spans that gap. He's our one and only bridge. He's our one and only mediator. He's our one and only way home. And His identity as a human, but who is also God, His identity is the very foundation for our hope. Jesus is the God-man who came from heaven to the earth. Now, I can do best when I draw a picture. Jesus is the one who gave up heaven. He is the one who put on flesh, came from heaven, and dwelt among us. He is the God-man. Now, because He is the God-man, He is able to do some things for us. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, the gospel is God's power unto our salvation. The gospel. Now, you know, it's amazing. The Bible interprets itself. Really, it does. This is a strange little term, gospel. What does it mean? Well, you know, sometimes when two people sit down and try to study God's Word together, sometimes you'll hear the expression, well, that's your interpretation. And then someone else will say, yes, but what is your interpretation? Really, the Bible interprets itself. Here is a strange word, gospel. What does it mean? The Bible interprets itself. Let's go to God. God, would you interpret your own word? What does gospel mean? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4, the Bible tells us that the gospel basically is the death and the burial and the resurrection of this God-man, Jesus Christ. The gospel is the death burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm grateful that the Bible interprets itself, that the Bible tells us what the gospel is. In Romans chapter 4, verses 24 and 25, the Bible tells us that our ability to be saved is basically to believe in the resurrection from the dead of this God-man, Jesus Christ. And of course, that's the gospel. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the gospel. Now, the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is God's power to save us. Now, why? Well, it's because, you see, these specific events take care of some specific needs that you and I as human beings have. You see, we have a sin problem. And in God's judicial system, since man has sinned, man must die. God put on flesh. He became human. And He marched to that cross in order to take care of our sin problem. A human being had to die because you and I sinned. He is our substitute. I like what the Bible has to say in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7. The Bible says that we can have redemption. We can have forgiveness through the blood of Jesus Christ. His blood. Praise God, He shed His blood through which we can have forgiveness of our sins. His blood is our payment for the penalty we owe. He is our penalty payment. Jesus is our penalty payment through that blood He shed on the cross. The gospel is God's power to save us. He, through His blood, takes away our sin problem, blots it out. Now, another part of the gospel is the death and the resurrection. Resurrection from the dead, you see. Now, why did Jesus have to come out of that grave? Well, for one reason, He came out of the grave in order to prove His identity. You know, we've had a lot of fellows through history have claimed that they're God, but they're still in their graves. The Bible says in John chapter 20, verses 30 and 31, many other signs did Jesus do in the presence of many witnesses. But these were recorded, these were written, the Bible says there, that we might believe that Jesus is who He says He is. Now, the greatest of those signs is He came out of that grave. It's not every day that a man will come out of the grave. Jesus came out of the grave, and He is still out of the grave. He has ascended and is sitting at the right hand of the Father, now in the heavenlies. Now, that's one reason He came out of the grave, but there is another reason as to why Jesus came out of the grave. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, now the first four verses have told us what the gospel is. Then the Apostle Paul, throughout the rest of the chapter, deals with only one of the aspects of the gospel, namely the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus came out of the grave to be our hope, you see, for our coming up and out of our graves. Right here in verse 20 it says, "Now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." In other words, because He as a human being conquered the grave, He made it possible for other humans to come out of our graves. He is the first fruit. Over here in verse 42 He says, "The body, our human bodies, the body is sown in corruption, but it is raised in incorruption. Our bodies, the body is sown in dishonor, but the same body is raised in glory. It, the body, is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body," simply meaning prepared for this realm, "but it is raised a spiritual body," simply meaning that our human bodies are raised and simply prepared for that other realm. Now, over here in verses 51 and 52, the Bible says, "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." You see, the body as it is now, where is it? Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom. Therefore, our bodies must be changed, and they will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. The trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be, there it is again, changed. For this corruptible, our human bodies, must put on incorruption. This mortal, our bodies as they are now, must put on immortality. When this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, "Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory?" Now, what's in the grave? The body. these bodies will be changed, simply prepared for that other realm, and these bodies will be able to go to heaven. You see, the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23 that you and I, we who are humans, are not complete. We are not whole, complete, unless we are body, soul, and spirit. I tell you, when I tell you that Larry wants to go to heaven, there's none of me that I want to leave behind. I want my body there. I want my soul there. I want my spirit there. And I'm not whole, I'm not complete, unless I am body, soul, and spirit. Now, Jesus came out of the grave as a human being in a resurrected human body, in His resurrected human body, in order to be the first fruits for us, that we might see our bodies come up and out of our graves. The Bible says now in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10 that two things were brought to light, that is, they are exposed so that we can see them, brought to light through this gospel, namely life and immortality, T-A-L-I-T-Y. Jesus died on the cross, take away my sins. I deserve to die myself, but He took my place. Now I have life. He came out of the grave in order that I might have hope for my own immortality. He brought life and immortality to light through this gospel. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10. Look at Fitz hand in glove. I have life because of His death. I have immortality because of His resurrection. No wonder. The gospel, the death and the resurrection from His grave is God's power to save me. Wow! Praise God for Jesus because of who He is. He is the God-man. Marched to that cross, He came out of that grave able to save me and take me home to heaven. Praise God for Jesus Christ.
He left the splendor of heaven, knowing His destiny. It was the lonely hill of Golgotha that You lay down His life for me. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry. There's no stars in the sky, and the sparrow can't fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this, if that isn't love.
Now, how do we get in on the gospel of Jesus Christ? You know, when we give our word of testimony, when we tell our stories about how we believe we were saved, what we are doing is we are telling what we believe happened to us as to how we appropriated salvation in our lives, how we appropriated the saving blood of Jesus, where we met Christ, where we came into contact with His blood through which we know is the only thing that we can be saved. In other words, we are telling our stories as to where we believe we appropriated salvation and the gospel and the blood of Jesus in our lives, right? According to the Bible, though, where are we to appropriate the blood of Jesus, the gospel of Christ, into our lives? Well, the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 through 9, after Paul's general introduction, he says that one of these days the Lord Jesus is going to be revealed from heaven with His mighty angels in flaming fire. Now, you see, he's talking about the second coming of Christ in flaming fire. When he does that, he is going to take vengeance on some folks, some people who, number one, do not know God. Now, let's write down something here. I'm going to write down the word believe, because we're talking about a faith response. What does it mean to know God? Well, it's an all-comprehensive term, frankly. It means to, number one, believe that God exists, sure. It means to believe that this is His Word. You do believe that, I hope. That this is His Word, His revelation. It means to believe the specifics of that Word. It's an all-comprehensive term to say, I believe you, Lord, and I'm ready to commit my life to you. For you see, the Bible says in Luke chapter 13, verse 3, in the Bible, that we have to commit ourselves to Jesus. He says, except you repent, you will perish. And there is another one of those life and death statements. What if I don't repent? I'll perish. Luke 13, verse 5. What if I don't repent? I'll perish. It's one of those life and death statements. If I don't repent, I'll perish. And by the way, do I have to believe this in order to be saved? Is there a life and death statement? Yes. In Romans 10, verse 9, the Bible says, if I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead, I'll be saved. What if I don't? In fact, it also says, if I confess the Lord Jesus with my mouth, I'll be saved. What if I don't? It's a life and death statement. Well, anyway, back here at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 through 9, he says, I will taste God's vengeance, you see, if I don't, number one, know God. And I've written down the word believe. But now, let's continue in the verse. He says he's going to take vengeance out upon those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. These, he says, shall be punished with everlasting destruction. Now, we have a four-letter word, hell. Everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His power. Now, if I'm going to escape His vengeance, if I'm going to escape being punished with everlasting destruction, I have to, number one, through faith, come to know God, and I have to obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right? Let me write down that strange little phrase. I must know God, and I must what? Obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what's the gospel? Well, that's what we've been talking about, isn't it? The gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. How in the world do I obey the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? It's one thing to believe it, but it's entirely another to obey it. I'm not going to obey anything until, first of all, I believe it, right? But based upon my faith, how do I obey the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? Now, I know that I must. Whatever it means, right? I know that I must. If I don't, it's going to be God's vengeance and eternal, everlasting destruction. So, my response is, Lord, what do you mean? Obey the gospel. The Bible interprets itself. The Bible interprets itself. So, let's go exploring. In the Bible, in the book of Romans, chapter 6, in verse 17, the Bible says to those at Rome who had already understood this and who had already obeyed the gospel, Paul, who was inspired by God to write it, said, God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed, there's the word, you obeyed from the heart. You see, it's a faith response. That form of teaching or doctrine to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. When were they set free from sin? When they obeyed from the heart that form of teaching. Now, what has he been talking about? Well, let's run our eyes on back up and get the first part of the chapter so we can find out what he's been discussing. Look here. Here he tells us, as the Bible interprets itself, how we obey the gospel. Now, what's the gospel? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Look here. He says, do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Therefore, we were buried. There's the death. There's the burial. Therefore, we were buried with Him. But how? Through baptism into death. That just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Now, here is the beautiful picture. Right there, starting with verse 3, he says, know you not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into His death? We were buried, not sprinkled, not poured, buried with Him through baptism into death,
that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Now look at this very next verse. He says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 5, here is the life and death statement. If we have been united together in the likeness of His death, the likeness of His death, what did they do with Him when He died? They buried Him. And He's been talking about the burial right here through baptism. If we have been united together in the likeness of His death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of His resurrection. There's that little word, if. What if I choose not to be baptized in the likeness of His death? There's not going to be the likeness of His resurrection for me. There is that life and death statement. In other words, I must be baptized into the gospel. That's how I appropriate the gospel, God's power to save me, in my life. I do it in this form of teaching, and it is precisely then that I am set free from sin. The Bible says where, in fact, one becomes a Christian. In the book of Galatians, in chapter 3, right here in verse 26, he says, now, you're all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. You see, it's a faith response. But the very next verse, he says, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. How does one become a Christian? How does one put on Christ? The Bible says, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ, put on Christ. So, here is an individual. He loves the Lord. He believes that God exists. He believes that this Bible is His Word. He believes in the specific events. Where does he have his sin problem washed away in the blood of Jesus? Well, where was the blood shed? In his death. How does he get into his death? Romans 6. You're baptized into his death. It is precisely there that the blood reaches his sins, washes it away, and he has life. It is precisely in baptism, according to Galatians 3, in verse 27, that he puts on Christ. Then it's no wonder when he is raised out of this obedient act, he is in Christ. Now the thing that sets this person apart from this person is Christ. Where does he put on Christ? Where does he become a Christian? Based upon his faith, he obeys the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is precisely there that he puts on Christ and he becomes a Christian. It is precisely here that God, through Christ, pays his sin penalty, that his legal problem in God's judicial system may be taken care of. I obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is how I was saved. I know that I'm saved because I obeyed the specific commands of Jesus Christ and the gospel. Will you, right now, obey that gospel?
There's just something about that name.
Hello. Thank you for these few minutes that we have together. You know, we are talking about the most important thing we can possibly talk about, and that is salvation in Christ. After I first became a Christian, I wanted to know what church I was to belong to, who I was to fellowship. I knew that the Bible spoke of a church. In Matthew 16, for example, I knew that Jesus had said, upon this rock I will build my church.
And I knew that God wants us to belong to a church, but I wanted to find out which church, you know, in a world where there are so many churches, 300, 500, 700, I hear on up to 900 different kinds of churches, filled with precious people who are trying their best to serve the Lord, in a world where there are so many different kinds of churches, in fact, denominations, which means churches are divided apart from each other. I wondered, does God's church exist today? Is it possible to find God's people, God's church today? Or are they all God's church? Sort of like an umbrella effect, you know, where that God looks down upon the world and he sees his church, and yet underneath the umbrella, he sees all these different kinds of denominations. Are they all God's church? Well, I decided I'd try to use some common sense. I knew that God's church is an organization, and so I decided, well, what if I were to move to town and I were to decide I was going to join the Rotary Club? How would I know, after I had finished joining up with the club, that I hadn't ended up joining the Lions Club? Well, I decided that obviously they are two different organizations, and as organizations, they have certain identification marks. For example, what's its name? Surely the Rotary Club is going to have a different name than the Lions Club. What are the members called? How is it governmentally organized? Surely it's going to be organized differently from the Lions Club. What are we going to do in our meetings together? Who's the founder of it? What rule book are we going to use? What are the terms of membership into it? And I thought, well, God has an organization called the church, doesn't he? And so I thought, well, it might be good to go to God and say, God, you have an organization? Well, in your organization, God, what's its name? What are the members called? How is your organization governmentally organized? Who's the founder of your organization? What's the rule book we are supposed to use? What are we going to do in our meetings together? What are the terms of membership? What must people understand? What must people do in order to become a member of your organization called the church? Now, I found out, you know, in the Bible, that every time I read the word church before I got to Acts chapter 2 in the Bible, it was always referred to in the future tense. That is, it's going to come. In Matthew 16, for example, Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. You see, that's future tense. When I got to Acts chapter 2, and then starting there and proceeding throughout the rest of the New Testament, I found out that every time the word church is used, it's always used in the present tense. So, in Acts chapter 2, Jesus did what he promised he would do, and that is establish his church. I did find out, as I asked God those questions and then went to his word to find the answers, that this idea of an umbrella where God looks down and he sees his church, but underneath the umbrella are all these denominations, that particular idea is by all means not scriptural. God doesn't even talk about a second cousin to that idea. Well, I found out as I went to God's word to find the answers that God's organization, his church, is extremely unique. It's one of a kind. For example, in John chapter 17, this is where Jesus is praying to the Father just before he's arrested and taken to that kangaroo court and then taken to the cross and crucified. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's praying to the Father. And he says, not only do I pray for these, talking about his apostles that he had been praying for, but he says, I pray for all those the world over who will come to believe on me through their word. He says, that they all may be one. He says, Father, even as you are in me and I am in you. He prayed that all the people in the world who would come to believe in Jesus would be one. I discovered in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, starting at verse 10, that the Apostle Paul said, I plead with you by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that you all speak the same thing and that there be no denominations, no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and same judgment. I found out there that God absolutely condemns division, condemns denominationalism. He wants us to be of the same mind and same judgment. Jesus prayed that we would all be one, even as he and the Father are one.
I was glad to know that, because I want to know that God has a unity of thought and a unity of believers. And I, frankly, want to belong to that one church. I found out in the Bible, in Ephesians chapter 4, that there are several things that God lists there that He says there are one each of, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and so on. In Ephesians 4 and verse 4, He says there is one body. I wanted to know what body He's talking about. Well, I kept exploring, and I found out that back over in the first chapter of Ephesians, and the very last two verses, He said that God had given Christ to be head over all things, get this, to the church, which is His body. What is His body? The church. All right, if the church is the body of Christ, and in chapter 4 He says there is one body, how many churches does God say He has? One. God has one church. I want to belong to that one church. Can I belong to that church? I can if I have the blueprint of that church. You know, if I had the desire and the money to duplicate the Superdome found in New Orleans and build it in Nashville, could I do it? I could, to the exact detail of the blueprint I would have in hand. Can I do that with God's original church, the one found there in the first century? Yes, I can, to the exact detail of the blueprint that I have in hand. Here's the blueprint. God has the organization, and any organization, you know, has certain identification marks that sets it apart from any other organization in the world, whether it be a social club or another church or a government or anything. God has the blueprint. This is filled with identification marks of God's organization that He calls the church. Now, let's not misunderstand. Obviously, the church is not the Savior. The church does not save. The church cannot save. There is only one Savior, and His name is Jesus. It is Jesus who says, "No man cometh to the Father but by Me." The point is, once a person is saved by Jesus, the result is God adds him to the church. Now, that's what the Bible says in the very last verse of Acts chapter 2. God established in Acts chapter 2, the Bible says, the church. And the Bible says God adds people to that church once they are saved. Let's go to God now and ask God some of these very sensible, practical questions concerning the identification marks of the church we read about in the Bible. Okay? God, You say that You have an organization called the church. Well, what's its name? Now, don't you suppose that we ought to allow God to name His own church? Did you know that He does that? In the Bible, for example, in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, it's Jesus who said, "Upon this rock I will build My church." Who said it? Jesus said it. Therefore, it is the church of Jesus. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 28, it's called the church of the Lord. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, it's referred to as the church of God. In Romans 16, verse 16, it's called the church of Christ. In Ephesians 4, verse 12, it's called the body of Christ. In Romans 7, it's referred to as the bride of Christ. Now, in Acts chapter 8, in verse 1, it is simply and only referred to as the church. Now, more than a name, actually these terms refer to the relationship that the church enjoys with God and with Christ. In other words, it's the Lord's church. It's God's church. It's Christ's church. It's Christ's body, Christ's bride. It belongs to Him. Now, we have a lot of precious churches across the country who wear the name belonging to another man. They wear a man's name. Maybe you belong to such a church. But did you know that the Bible knows of no such name? Let's let the church belong to God, belong to Christ. Let's let Him name His own church. Now, just because God has given us various names, is He saying these are the names of My various denominations? No. Because you see, it's the Bible that says that God wants us all to speak the same thing and that there be no divisions, no denominations among us,
but that we be perfectly joined together in the same mind and same judgment. You know, if I were to decide one day I were going to get into the car and drive up and down the street and look for God's church, how would I find it? Just because, say, for example, I were to find on a church building somewhere the name Church of God, Church of Christ, Bride of Christ, Body of Christ, would I know immediately that that's God's first century original one and only church? No. Now, they have the right name. It is a biblical, scriptural name. They have made their first step in the right direction. But you see, there are other identification marks that we must respect if we're going to belong to God's one and only church. So, we have to continue exploring. Let's go back to God and say, God, you have an organization? What are the members called? Who are members of your organization? Should we respect God's word enough to allow ourselves to be called what God wants us to be called? Well, in the Bible, in Acts chapter 20 and verse 7, the members are simply called disciples. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 2, they're called saints, those who have been sanctified by the blood of Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 11, they are called brethren. You know why? Because they have a very special relationship with one another. They are brothers in Christ. 1 John 3 and verse 1, in the same family, they are children of God. In Acts 11 and verse 26, they are simply and only called Christians. Just Christians, that's all. You know what we do today? We want to have hyphenated Christians. What I mean by that is, somehow we want to put the name of our denomination right here and then put a hyphen after it and then put the word Christian. Someone steps up to us and says, I hear you're a Christian. And we say, well, yes, by all means, I am. And they ask, well, what kind of a Christian are you? Then what we understand they are asking is, what denomination do you belong to? And we say, well, I am this kind of a Christian. Say, for example, what if I were to belong to the Church of the Bethlehemite? Now, I don't even know if there is such a church, but just for illustration purposes. And someone steps up to me and says, Larry, I understand you're a Christian. I would say, yes. And he would ask, what kind of a Christian are you? Well, using today's terminology, I would say, well, I'm a Bethlehemite Christian. You're a what? Where is that found in Scripture? It's not there. Why can't we kick these hyphens out and just be Christians, just be disciples, just be saints, just be brethren, children of God, just be Christians? There is no such thing as a hyphenated Christian. What if we were to jump into the time tunnel, say, for example, and we were to go back 2,000 years and we were to see the Apostle Paul coming down the street? Hi, Paul. I understand you're a Christian. And we were to ask, Paul, what kind of a Christian are you? What do you suppose Paul would say? Well, I'm a faithful Christian. Oh, yes, Paul, I know that. I've read your letters. But Paul, what kind of a church do you belong to? What kind of a church? He would say, well, I belong to the Lord's church, Christ's church, God's church, Christ's body, Christ's bride. Or in Acts chapter 8 and verse 1, he would say, I just simply belong to the church. I'll be quite frank with you. I want to belong, speaking personally, to that church. Don't you suppose that Peter and Paul and Bartholomew and Thomas and all these that we read of in the Bible, don't you suppose they all belong to the same church? It's that church that I want to belong to. Well, let's continue as we discover God's identification marks of His New Testament church. God, you say you have an organization? Well, how is your organization governmentally organized? The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, in the very last two verses, that God made Christ to be head over all things to the church. In other words, Christ is the head of the church. In fact, in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 23, the very words are used. Christ is the head of the church. Now, you know, for there to be one head for one body, that's normal. I have never yet seen one body have two heads. And especially when some churches insist that, well, Christ is the head in heaven, but he has another head on earth. Wait a minute. It was Jesus who said, just before he was about to ascend and go back to heaven, in Matthew 28, all authority, he says, has been given to me in both heaven and on earth. Jesus is the one and only head. Now, just as there are not two heads for one body, there's not one head for 900 bodies. There's only one head for one body. Jesus is the head, the one and only head of His one and only body, the church. Now, let's go back to God and say, God, does that mean that your various congregations of your one body, your one church on earth, are unorganized? No. For you see, the Bible says there are to be elders, deacons, evangelists, teachers, and then members. Elders? Does that mean that we can just simply go through the crowd and pick out men that we would like to serve as elders over us? No, because you see, they have certain qualifications according to the Bible that they must abide by. In 1 Timothy chapter 3 and in Titus chapter 1, there are listed qualifications for these individuals. The deacons also have qualifications, 1 Timothy chapter 3 of the Bible. An evangelist, according to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 and 5, is to simply preach the word. There are teachers, Ephesians 4, verse 11, and the rest are members. That's it. It's almost too simple to believe, isn't it? There is no governmental hierarchy in God's simple New Testament original church. It is too simple, almost, for some people to believe. Well, let's go back to God and say, God, You have an organization. Give me another identification mark that I might know how to recognize it. And you know He does give other identification marks. Let's ask God, Lord, what are we supposed to do in our meetings together, when we get together? Well, the Bible answers that. The Bible says, for example, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 46, that first century church met daily. I mean, they were together every day. In Ephesians 5 and verse 19, they sang together. In Acts chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, they prayed together. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, they studied God's Word together. They gave. I mean, the Bible said they sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. They were concerned about reaching out to one another and providing for each other. They gave. Now, while they were daily together, singing and praying and studying God's Word together and giving as anyone had need, they had a special reason for getting together on the first day of the week. In Acts chapter 20 and verse 7, the Bible says that their particular purpose for coming together on the first day of the week was to partake of the Lord's Supper, remembering the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Every time the first day of the week rolled around, they had a special reason for coming together. That is to partake of the Lord's Supper. And that's it. That's what they did in their meetings together. It's almost too simple to believe, isn't it? God, You say You have an organization? Let's ask another identification mark question. What book are we supposed to use? Let's ask the Lord that one. What rule book are we supposed to use? The Bible tells us. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, the Bible says that all Scripture is inspired by God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, that is, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. In other words, it's these Scriptures that God has inspired. And these Scriptures are all we need. They thoroughly furnish us unto every good work. So let's put away our different little books, our manuals and our catechisms and our confessions of faith, and let's come just to the Bible and study just the Bible. Here is our authority, isn't it? Here's the rule book. Well, let's ask God one final question. Lord, You say that You have an organization that You call the church. What must I do to become a member of it? What are Your requirements of membership into it? Isn't that a plausible question? Isn't that a sensible question? If I were going to join the Rotary Club, I would certainly go maybe to the president of the Rotary Club, and I would say, I want to join your club. And then I would ask him, what are your requirements of membership? And he would give me those requirements, and I would understand them. And if I complied with them, then I would assume that I had been added to that club. Let's go to God. God, You say You have an organization called the church. What are Your requirements of membership into it? And you know, It's amazing how he tells us. In Mark chapter 16, for example, as well as in Matthew 28, it's Jesus who is about to ascend and go back into heaven. He is standing around with his disciples, and he tells them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel." The gospel. That's the message Jesus demands that must be preached. The gospel, that's a strange little term. What is the gospel? Well, you know, it's amazing. The Bible interprets itself. The Bible explains, defines its own word. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and the first four verses, the Bible tells us that basically the gospel is the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It tells us there that it's the gospel that saves us. Paul also said it in another place in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. He says, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is God's power to save you." The gospel is God's power to save. Two chapters later, you know, Matthew 28 and Mark 16 are telling of what Jesus told those disciples just before he was about to ascend and go back into heaven. Two chapters later, that is in Acts chapter 2, the Apostle Peter preached for the first time the gospel. In Acts chapter 2, he preaches the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In Acts 2 verse 37, those who were standing around and who had heard Peter preach this gospel asked, "What must we do?" They recognized they were lost, much like I at one time recognized that I was lost. And I asked the question, "What must I do to be saved?" That's what they asked. What must I do to be saved? Peter, inspired by God to say it, tells them what they must do to be saved. When they did it, the Bible says the Lord added them to the church. Which church? This church the Bible describes, the one we've been talking about today. God added them, those who complied with Peter's teachings. God added them to the church. Now, quite frankly, I want to belong to that church, that same church, not one established 200 years later, 300 years later, 500, 1,200 years later. I want to belong to that church. Well, doesn't it stand to reason, therefore, that if I understand the same thing that the Apostle Peter told these people to understand, and if I obey the same thing that Peter told these people to obey, then I too will become a member of the same church that God added these people to? Obviously, right? Well, what did he tell them to do? Well, when they asked him in verse 37, "What shall we do to be saved?" he said in verse 38, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins." In verse 41, the Bible says, "Then those who gladly received his word were baptized." I mean, when they understood what Peter told them to do to be saved, they did it. They were baptized. How many of them? 3,000 of them, the Bible says. When? That same day. That very same day. You see, a person can't be saved in his sins. Peter had said, "Repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins." That's how you get remission of sins, as you appeal to Christ and the gospel in baptism. They did it, and when they did it, he said in verse 47, the Lord added them to the church, those who were being saved. What church? What church? The only one God has whose identification marks are right here in the Bible. I have a question for you. Based upon your having heard God's word today, if the Lord were to come right now, I mean this very moment, can you say for sure, nothing doubting, that you'd go home to be with the Lord, to live forever? Does your church teach what you've heard today? If not, why not? If not, Why then don't you obey the Lord and become a member of His church? Do it today. God bless you. I'll see you next time.
There's just something about that name.
Hi. It happened in Anderson, Indiana, at the O.C. Lewis Gymnasium. It was the championship game. The place was electrifying as the two teams played the hotly contested basketball championship. People were ecstatic as they cheered their own teams to victory. Finally, after the long and exhausting and super exciting game was coming to an end, the visiting team was ahead by just 2 points, and it was just 3 minutes left to go in the game. Finally, the referees called a foul against the visiting team. That meant that the home team could even the score. Well, excitement rose. It seemed as though the place were about to explode. The Anderson boy stepped up to the foul line for his free throw, but before he could throw, all of a sudden, a referee on the floor slumped and fell to the floor. In seconds, boys were at his side. A doctor was called in. In a few more seconds, he was carried out of the gymnasium. And then came the solemn announcement. The referee was dead. Dead? What happened? Was it a heart attack? Was it that there was too much excitement in the place for him to be able to handle? What had happened? Well, the loud, yelling, sports-minded crowd all of a sudden became a very sober-faced bunch of people. It was such a shock to everyone who was present, they couldn't finish the game. What was an exciting arena of sports became as though it were a mausoleum. You know, every once in a while, there's something that hits us in such a way that reminds us that the game we're playing, whatever that game is so short. What was so exciting isn't anymore. What was so important isn't anymore. It's as though someone has thrown cold water in our face. We're shocked. We're stunned. An atomic bomb has just been exploded on our sense of values. We're shocked. We're stunned to the core of our beings.
There was a man not too many days ago who walked into his rather shabby apartment in a downtown area of a rather large metropolitan city. He was distraught, discouraged, ready to call it quits. In fact, he decided to take his own life. He shut the door and locked it, and then he took a towel and put it at the bottom of the door in order to seal the crack. He walked over, shut the windows and locked them, and then pulled the drapes. He walked over then and pulled the hose off his gas heater. He then turned the jet on, and then he lay down on the bed to die. With his breathing the noxious fumes, it seemed that his sense of hearing became more and more keenly acute. It seemed that the spewing gas was getting louder and louder, and he thought, well, someone passing by might hear this spewing gas, and it might dawn on them that I'm trying to kill myself, and they'll come in here and try to stop me. So, to drown out the sound, he reached over and turned the radio on. And the first words he heard were these: "Are you ready to meet your God?" It stunned him. It shocked him.
He rushed over and burst open the windows to get some fresh air, and he turned the gas off. It saved his life. You know, it seems that when we are forced to confront God, that's when we find ourselves stunned. It's the wise one, though. It's the very fortunate one who will confront God before death. Are you ready to meet your God? It is a most profound question. If the Lord were to come right now, can you say for sure, nothing doubting, you know, you would go home to be with Him, to live forever? What is your answer? What is your answer as you sit right there? Are you ready? Someone has said you can laugh God out of your schools, you can laugh God out of your books, you can laugh God out of your life, but you cannot laugh God out of your death. There was a boy one day talking to his grandfather, and the man said, "You're about to graduate from high school this year." He said, "I'm proud of you." And then he asked him, "What are you going to do next year?" And the boy said, "Well, I'm going to go to college." "What then?" the man asked him. And the boy said, "Well, I suppose, you know, after 4 years, I'll graduate and I want to go to medical school." "What then?" asked the grandfather. The boy said, "Well, I suppose I'll graduate and become a doctor." "What then?" asked the grandfather. And the boy said, "Well, I'll have a family, have children." "What then?" persisted the grandfather. And the boy said, "Well, I suppose I'll grow old and die." "What then?" asked the grandfather. And the boy said, "Well, I suppose I'll go to meet my God." And the grandfather said, "Well, I was wondering where you were going to fit God into your schedule of life." Are you ready to meet your God? There's a great day coming. Are you ready to meet your God? You know, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 25, and really the first 13 verses, that God has appointed a day. In the Bible, in Acts chapter 17 and verse 31, He has appointed a day on which He will judge the world. The Bible says, He will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom He has ordained. Hebrews 9, verse 27, the Bible says, "It is appointed for men to die once, but after this, the judgment." You only go around once in life. Get all the gusto you can. Oh, let's change that. You only go around once in life, and then the judgment. There's a great day coming. Are you ready? If the Lord were to come right now, are you ready? I want to give you some pertinent facts, if I may, concerning that great day coming. What's going to happen on that day? Let's take a look at what the Bible has to say. God says is going to happen on that final day. The Bible says that all will be there. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10, the Bible says we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. None of us will miss that day. You know, it is amazing that there are some who believe they will miss that day. John was at one time my next door neighbor. John was a mortician. He was a good neighbor. The problem was, he never became a Christian. In fact, the only time that John would ever talk to me about Jesus Christ was when John was drunk. When he sobered up, he wasn't interested. John, a few years ago, contracted a fatal disease and died. I preached his funeral. I remember one day that we were out in my front yard. I believe I had just finished washing my car. And I remember I was stooped over turning off the faucet there in my front yard, and John was standing behind me, and he said, "Larry, when I die, I want you to just simply bury me in a pair of pajamas, because all I'm going to do is just sleep forever." Well, you know, that's a comforting thought. It's a grand idea that we don't have to face anyone for how we've lived in life. It's a great idea. The problem is, it's just not true. For you see, the Bible says in John chapter 5, the Gospel according to John in chapter 5, that all of us are going to come up and out of our graves. Now, those who are saved will go into heaven. Those who are not saved will face God's awful, eternal judgment. But all of us are going to come up and out of our graves. The Bible says in Romans chapter 14, verses 10 through 12, we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Each of us shall give account of himself to God. Now, you know, when we stand there on that final day, now, we're all going to be there. None of us are going to miss that final day. The Bible also says that everything about us will be revealed. There's nothing God is going to miss about us. Let me ask you something. Do you have any secrets? I mean, real secrets? Something that is so secretive that not even that husband of yours knows about it. Not even that wife. Not that son or daughter. Mom and dad don't know this about you. In fact, no one knows it about you. It's a real secret. Secret. Only God knows. You and God. Only the two of you know. Do you have any secrets like that? Well, the Bible says, if you're not saved, if you're not a Christian, everything will be revealed. There is nothing that's going to be hidden. You see, the Bible says in Romans chapter 2 and verse 16, God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, there is no creature hidden from His sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. There is nothing that will be hidden. All will be revealed. We will be judged by what we have done in this life. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, verses 12 and 13, it's John who speaks. He said, I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. We will be judged by what we have done in this life. We will also be judged by what we have said in this life, by the very words that have come out of our mouths. The Bible says, it's Jesus now who speaks in Matthew 12, verse 36, for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. What we do, what we say, has bearing upon how we will be judged on that final day. Now, not just by what we have said or what we have done, but even our intent will judge us. The Bible says in Matthew 5, verse 28, whoever looks at a woman to lust after her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. That's the intent. The Bible says in 1 John 3, verse 15, whoever hates his brother, that's intent. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know, the Bible says, that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. The Bible says in 1 Chronicles 28, verse 9, the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the intent of the thoughts. We will be judged even by the intentions of our heart. I mean, everything is going to be revealed. It is amazing. There's nothing that God is going to miss. He has some kind of gigantic computer. Nothing is going to be missed. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12, now it's John who speaks, and he says, I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. These books are the books that you and I have written by what we've said, by what we've done, even by the very intent of our hearts. He said, then another book was opened, which is the book of life. Now that's this book. That's the Bible. It will be there. And the dead were judged, he said, according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. In other words, there will be the books that you and I have written, and then there will be this book. This book, God's Word, will be there on that final day. And He will look at what we've written by what we've done and said and have intended to do, even, or intended not to do. And He will judge those books by this book to see if they balance out. This is the book that will be there on that final day, and this is the book that will judge us. You see, the Bible says, as it's Jesus Himself who is speaking, in John chapter 12, verse 48, he who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. Jesus asks in Luke 6, verse 46, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? And what has Jesus said? Well, in John chapter 8 and verse 24, it's Jesus who said, if you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins. What did Jesus say? In Romans chapter 10 and verse 9, he said, if you confess the Lord with your mouth
and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. What has Jesus said? In Luke 13, he said, "Except you repent, you will perish." What has Jesus said? In John chapter 3, he said, "Except a man be born of water and the Spirit, he will not see the kingdom of heaven." What did Jesus say? In Mark 16, verses 15 and 16, he said, "Go into all the world and preach that gospel. He who believes it and is baptized shall be saved. He who doesn't believe it is going to be lost." And Jesus asks, Luke 6, verse 46, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" God's Word will judge us on that last day. Now, there's something else that God's Word says that will happen on that last day. The Bible says that each of us will stand by himself before God, will stand alone. The Bible says in Romans chapter 14, verse 12, that each of us must give account of himself to God, will stand alone. Once a mother stepped up to her son, and she said, "Son, we've tried our best to live godly lives before you. We've taught you, we've trained you in God's Word, and yet you've not yet become a Christian." She said, "If you don't become a Christian on that final day, because of the lives we've lived versus you're not having become a Christian," she said, "we're going to find ourselves standing there bearing witness against you." No parent wants to do that. But why is that so? Why will they stand there bearing witness against their son? Because each of us will stand alone before the judgment seat of Christ. It'll be as though the judge is there standing behind his gigantic bench. The courtroom will be packed. We'll want to run, but we'll find no friend in sight. And when we stand up before the judge, he will ask, "Is there no one to defend the accused?" And then the silence, the awesome, overpowering silence, will be the answer. It will come back saying, "No one, Your Honor. No one." Each of us who are not Christians will stand before the judgment seat alone, and no one will defend us. Are you ready? If the Lord were to come right now, can you say for sure, nothing doubting, you'd go home to be with the Lord, to live forever? There's a great day coming. Are you ready? Muffy Brandon was once White House social secretary. She tells an interesting story. She says that one day Prince Philip was due to visit the president. It had not been established as to which portico the prince was to come. She looked out and saw the prince's limousine driving up the driveway. She rushed down to the east portico and found that there were two moppers there with their buckets. The carpet had been rolled back and they were busily cleaning it up. She looked out and saw that it was to that entrance the prince was coming. They quickly threw the rug down, they put the buckets in the closet, and she said that she was in the closet as the prince was escorted serenely by. Narrow escapes. We've all had narrow escapes, haven't we? You know, there are a lot of people who believe that, well, they can see God coming. They can see, so to speak, him coming up their driveway, and they'll have time to get their house in order before they have to face him. The Bible says, "Watch. You do not know the day nor the hour." The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." We don't know when God is coming. It is impossible for us to get our house in order as we see God coming up the driveway. I mean, when that trumpet sounds, it's over. We don't have time to draw another breath. We don't have time to think another thought. I mean, when the trumpet sounds, that's it. The phone rang one day. The father got up to answer it.
And the voice on the other end said, "Sir, are you Mr.?" And he called him by name. And the father said, "Yes, I am." The voice on the other end said, "Well, I am Chief so-and-so with the police department." He said, "Sir, do you have a son by the name of so-and-so?" And he called the name. And the father said, "Yes, I do." The chief said, "Well, sir, your son has been involved in an auto accident, and you and your wife need to come very quickly to the emergency room." Well, mom and dad jumped up, of course, and they got into their car and ran down to the emergency room. When they walked in, they saw their son lying there, all bruised and bloody. Dad walked over, and of course, as you can imagine, he was saying, "Son, you're going to be all right. They're going to take care of you. You're going to get well. You're going to make it." And the son looked up and said, "Dad, don't lie to me." He said, "I know that I'm going to die." And he said, "Dad, I want you to do something for me when I die." He said, "When I die, I want you to bury me near the highway." He said, "And here's what I want you to put on my tombstone. Here lies a boy that died and went to hell. A boy who never heard his daddy pray." Mom, Dad, for your children's sake, if the Lord were to come right now, can you say for sure you're leading them to heaven? Can you say for sure, nothing doubting, that you all would go home to be with Him, to live forever? For your children's sake, are you taking your family to heaven? I have one more verse that I want to read to you today. It's found in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, starting with verse 7. It says that one of these days the Lord Jesus is going to be revealed from heaven with His powerful angels in flaming fire. It says right here that when He comes, He's going to take vengeance out upon those who do not know God and upon those who do not obey the gospel. He says right here, "These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His power." If the Lord were to come right now, can you say for sure, nothing doubting, you'd go home to be with Him, to live forever? There's a great day coming. Are you ready? Are you ready to meet your God?
Something.